Now, for this first option, I said it could support both of these theories. I could imagine a disk casting a circular shadow on the moon, and I could also imagine a sphere. Now, if you chose sphere, you have a good reason to argue with me, because if the Earth were disc-shaped, it would be a pretty huge coincidence of the alignment of that disk for it to actually cast a circular shadow. Think about this one a little more if that wasn't clear, and we can talk about it in the forums. For the second point, when traveling at sea, you can see farther from the top of the mast. I said this definitely points to the Earth being a sphere. And let's think about why. So here's my zoomed in drawing of a portion of the Earth, and here's a boat, an exaggerated boat. It's much larger than any actual boat on the Earth would be, but that's okay. In fact, this is a tool we're going to use a lot in physics. I exaggerate this drawing because I want to make a point clear. And in my head, when I'm thinking how a larger ship may allow a person to see farther, I'm going to exaggerate my test case in my head. Let's think of how far this guy could see. The guy standing on the deck. He could clearly see something down here, no problem. He could see something over here, that's fine. But then, this seems to be about as far as he can see. He can never see something over here, because, well, the Earth is in the way. Now, this sailor, she's standing up on the top of the boat, and this gives her a better angle, and actually an unobstructed view towards this farther place on the Earth. This clearly points towards a spherical Earth, because on a flat, disc-shaped Earth, this wouldn't happen. Actually, both sailors would be able to see anything. The third option is about the sun and the moon. But we're not talking about the sun and the moon, we're talking about the Earth, so I don't think this is really relevant. Again, you can make some arguments about this pointing towards sphere or disk, and you should do that. Go to the forums and talk about this point, but I thought the best answer was neither. This fourth point, that the sun appears lower in the sky as you travel north, I said best supports the idea that the Earth is a sphere, and let's talk about why. Well, here's our spherical Earth. Well, it's supposed to be spherical. My drawing may not be the best you've ever seen. And here's the sun. Now, in reality, the sun is much, much, much larger than the Earth, and it's much farther away. For our purposes, this drawing will be fine. So first, let's imagine this guy. He's standing pretty close to the equator. He's not very far north at all. For him, if he wants to see the sun, he can't be looking in this direction. He's got to look all the way up here. He's going to have to really crane his neck if he wants to look at the sun. We'd call this high in the sky. Now, let's imagine his friend, his green-haired northern-dwelling friend. Well, for her, to look at the sun, it's not very difficult at all. She doesn't have to crane her neck. In fact, just from the geometry of where she's standing and the sun's position, the sun appears very low in the sky to her. This would be really close to the horizon, and she doesn't have to crane her neck at all. This also points towards a spherical Earth. You wouldn't see any effect like this on a flat Earth. From the data we had, or from the data the Greeks had, some of it doesn't support either claim, the spherical or the disk hypothesis. But two of these points really seem to point towards a spherical Earth. None point towards a disc-shaped Earth, which means we can say with certainty, or some certainty, that even with the knowledge the Greeks had, we can know that the Earth is a sphere. Now, it's this last point, that the sun appears lower in the sky as we travel north, that Eratosthenes will exploit to determine the circumference of the Earth.